Hi, everybody. This is Angelique Duffield from Bright Spark Media, and thank you so much for joining us today on the Power of Free Show. I've got a very special guest for you. It's Melonie Dodaro from Top Dog Social Media, and she's going to be talking about LinkedIn strategy today. So we've known each other for quite a while, and I've actually attended Melonie's workshop a couple of years ago. We've kept in touch, obviously, on social media, and she actually lives in the same city as me, so it's quite nice to have a local guest on the show. And Melonie is an international number one best-selling author of The LinkedIn Code. She just released her book a few months ago, and it's number one in a number of different countries and a number of different categories, so that's pretty awesome. Congratulations on that. And she is a keynote speaker and a social selling evangelist, so she is a really big advocate of LinkedIn and how it can help your business. So why don't you just tell us a little bit about yourself, Melonie, and welcome to the show.
Hi, Angelique. Thanks for asking me to be here. I know it took us a while to make this happen, but it finally happened. So my company is Top Dog Social Media. We've been doing social media management and social media strategic plans and so forth for businesses for a number of years. But LinkedIn's always been my favorite social network. Because it's truly the only business social network. And, nobody's sharing about what they had for lunch or, their party pictures from the weekend. And as an entrepreneur, that kind of just really gravitated to me. But in addition to that, I've also seen both for our company as well as our clients' companies, LinkedIn's always consistently generated the vast majority of the leads that have come in. There's stats out there that say LinkedIn's 277% more effective for lead generation than Facebook or Twitter. That's with people using it completely wrong. So it's kind of cool to be able to share some different strategies and tactics that really work so that people can actually see a much higher conversion rate than that.
Oh, fantastic. I know I took your course a couple of years ago, and the strategy still remained quite the same, but you had some really great tips and information then, so I'm sure you'll have some great advice for people today. One of the things I remember you saying is that your LinkedIn profile is more important than your website. Do you want to talk about that?
Yeah. So, I mean, I'm a big advocate of course, having a good website and content and all that kind of stuff. So I would never discount any of that. But if your business is in any way reflective of you, so, your business is based on trust or it's based on people wanting to know who's the person behind this business. One of the things they'll often do when they're considering doing business with somebody is Google their name. LinkedIn's got really powerful Google search results, so it's usually your profile is usually showing up in one, two, or three spots on a Google search. Because LinkedIn's a network where people know that they can learn more about you, they typically will end up clicking on that first. So I always say that your LinkedIn profile is often your first online impression, and so you.
Right.
Ask yourself, what kind of online impression are you currently making? Because if this is where people are going to find out information about you, and there's very little in your profile, or, it's incomplete, it's poorly reflecting your personal brand as well as your company.
Right. Okay. I've seen a lot of people too. When I go and check them out, they've got the avatar, like the generic avatar. They haven't even filled in the picture yet. Or check them out and they've got but three sentences on there, or they've got their resume on their LinkedIn profile. So I know that's a really big no-no. So why don't you tell us some tips to create a really good profile? So what would the steps be that people need to take?
Yeah, great question. And I'm glad that you brought up the whole resume thing, because for so many years, that's kind of what people thought of LinkedIn. And LinkedIn's really gone through a major transformation over the last number of years. People are kind of getting out of that mindset that it's not just job seeker network. And so if you are looking for a job, there's no harm in having your profile very resume-like. But if you're looking at using it as a business building tool, you've got a business, you're looking for leads, prospects, and clients, you need to take a different approach. And so the approach that I'd suggest is very counterintuitive to what people might think. It's like, well, my LinkedIn profile should be all about me, right? Because it's my personal profile. Well, the reality of it is your prospects, your leads, your potential clients, they don't care about you. They only care about how you can help them. So when I'm structuring a LinkedIn profile, whether it's, in a workshop like the one that you attended where we worked through it all day, or it's me writing a profile for somebody, it doesn't matter. It's always about who are those ideal clients that you want to connect with specifically on LinkedIn, what are the problems and what are your solutions? And so I take people through a three-step formula for LinkedIn. The first one, basically, you know, I say, I mean, there's so much that you can do on LinkedIn, but you need to start there. You need to start with making sure that you've got that professional presence. And step one of the three-step formula is to get found. So you want to be showing up in the search results when people are looking for what you offer. And so a lot of times, business owners especially, will use terminology like, you know, I'm an owner and founder of XYZ company. I'm the owner and founder of Top Dog Social Media. People aren't looking for an owner or founder unless they're a salesperson who's looking to sell companies, which I teach them exactly how to do that, you know. Mm-hmm. But they're looking for, you know, a service or something that you offer. They're using different language. So one of the examples that I'll use is, you know, nobody's looking for the owner or founder. If they're looking for what I do, they're looking for a LinkedIn expert or a LinkedIn speaker or a social selling trainer or, you know, something like that. Those are the kind of words that they're going to be looking for. And the difference between what people look for on LinkedIn and Google is very significant. On Google, people are looking for things. So, again, in examples, how do I write a great LinkedIn profile? On LinkedIn, they're looking for that person to help them do it, that LinkedIn consultant, that LinkedIn,
right.
You know. So understanding the difference in terms of language and making sure that you don't get too creative. A lot of times we try to get a little creative with our you know, words that we're using to identify who we are or what we do. Your ideal clients are not going to get creative. They're not going to be looking for a branding extraordinaire. They're going to be looking for a branding expert or a personal branding expert. Or, you know what I mean? Like, they're going to be looking for a person. So you want to be very specific in choosing the right keywords that identify who you are. So, for example, if you're a website designer or developer, you're a website designer, you're a website developer. Don't get creative with that because that's what they'd actually be looking for.
Right.
I touched on that a little bit, and that's, you know, really creating that client-focused profile. So making sure that your profile, when somebody lands on it, whether it's they're doing a search for you or you've sent them a connection request and they want to check you out, that it speaks to them, that it actually, that they can self-select in your profile and say, Angelique, she does this and this. That's perfect. That's exactly what I actually need some help with. I should reach out to her, or I should definitely accept this connection request and follow up. So you want to make sure that they can identify who they are in there, so they see themselves in there. And they don't just see themselves in there in terms of the language that you use. Like, one of the things I'll do is, you know, say, you know, here's the types of clients I work with, and identify who they are. But also identify the problem that they have and the solution. Tie the solution that you offer. And you need to be really specific with who these ideal clients are, because if they can't see themselves in it, your profile is not going to resonate with them. So if you make the mistake that many people make and you try to market to everybody, you'll market to nobody. So it's really about getting that laser focus. And you know, you can have one generic one, like, you know, small business owners, but, you know, getting a little bit more specific than that is always a good thing. Sometimes it's challenging, you know, in that, you know, you really might service a large area, but the more specific you can get within LinkedIn, the better it is.
Okay, awesome. So I've talked about that with when I'm teaching about social media too, and I find it really interesting nowadays that people, especially on websites and their about section, are using all these made-up words. And I think besides not being a keyword that people are searching for, it's going to make it look really dated at some point in time. So I totally agree that you should be using keywords that people are searching for, and using just the common language. I know some people say that it really sets you apart if you call yourself, you know, the customer happiness agent or something like that. But like you said, people aren't actually searching for it. And the fact that in search in LinkedIn, why don't you talk a bit more about how the search works? Like you said, make sure you get found and then get them to take action. So how can they optimize their profile to show up better in a LinkedIn search?
By using the same keywords. So a lot of times what will happen is people will come up with a list of a dozen keywords, and they'll sprinkle them here and there and a little bit of everywhere. Well, it's impossible to optimize your profile to truly optimize your profile for more than about three or four keywords, because they need to be in a whole bunch of different places, and you can't fit 12 into those different places. So it's about choosing, getting very specific with that. I usually say find two or three.
Right.
You can go as far as three or four, depending on how long they are. and then putting them in a number of different spots from, you know, your headline, your summary, your title of your current work experience, the description of your current work experience. If it's relevant in a past work experience, the title and description of past work experience, skills section, in all these different areas. And actually, endorsements actually help with Google, or I'm sorry, with LinkedIn search results as well. It's been shown that if you've got more endorsements for a specific term than somebody else, you actually rank higher. So LinkedIn's algorithm has been changing a little bit recently. So there's a little bit of mystery around some of the changes that they've most recently made. But historically, those are the things that really have always worked. And I'm not exactly sure what they're doing right now. We're just kind of monitoring and trying to figure that out.
So like everybody else, we're waiting for the next change in the algorithm. You have a LinkedIn paid profile, don't you? You've got a LinkedIn paid profile. So what is the benefit to paying for a profile versus using the free profile?
That's a great question. And remind me in a second, Angelique, to get back to step three.
Oh, okay, yeah.
I'll cover that because I forgot after I got to step two.
Okay.
The advantage of a premium profile is there's a few things. One is now there's that cover photo that you can add at the top.
I saw that, yep.
That's going to be available soon to free accounts too, so that's not necessarily a premium feature. It was just rolled out to premium accounts first, and it's visually people see. The second thing is that you can see every single person that's viewed your profile. So if you want to take a look at file online, you can do that. You can see everybody in the last 90 days. With a free account, you can only see the last five. The most important feature of all, though, is the additional filtering in advanced search. So advanced search, if you're searching for prospects, so if you've got, you know, one of the things that we do is create lead generation campaigns for people, help them identify who their ideal clients are, show them how to find those people in advanced search and LinkedIn groups and do all that stuff. It works fine for most people with a free account unless they have a very specific type of client. So for example, if your market is going after Fortune 500 VPs of sales, for example, that's one of my target audiences, it's harder to find them because it doesn't allow you to do the additional search criteria where you can say, you know, companies of this size or Fortune 500 companies or Fortune 100 or Fortune 1000 companies. Those particular search filters are specific to premium accounts, whereas the other ones like keywords and geography and company and stuff like that, location, those things are available to free accounts. So for some people, they never need that because they don't need that additional search criteria because it's not relevant to who they're targeting. So
right.
I do a lot of training for sales teams, and a lot of the sales teams that I train work only with, you know, Fortune 500 companies or large companies. So for them, it's imperative.
Right. That makes a lot of sense.
Okay, so let's jump into step three.
Yeah, I was about to remind you to go back to step three.
Okay. Yeah, and so the third step, and this is the easiest one of all, is standout. You know, social media is noisy. LinkedIn's no different. Got over 300 million people. And so you want to stand out. And, you know, when we first started talking, Angelique, you talked about, you know, seeing some people's profiles with, you know, a sentence or two and, you know, no professional photo. Those are the simplest things to do to stand out. I mean, there's so many people that just don't take the time to fill out their profile. They don't have a professional headshot. That alone is enough to actually stand out in a network where people are doing it so poorly.
Right.
But then there's some additional things that you can do. Obviously, you know, really add some multimedia. LinkedIn's got a phenomenal, rich media ability to add videos, slideshare presentations, PDFs, stuff like that. And a video, I think, is ideal because it really allows that kind of a little bit more of a human element so people can get a feel for who you are a little bit more, just like we're doing right here.
Right.
That's great for your people, but adding that additional element of actually getting to see who the person is, like a Skype call versus a phone call, you know. So that's really helpful, as well as getting recommendations and endorsements, right? So that's social proof. And a lot of people, there's a lot of questions about, you know, really how important are endorsements? They're one click. They're not. They're, you know, they really don't hold a lot of weight. It's not like, oh, wow, you know, this person's got a zillion endorsements. They must be amazing. But strangely enough, with social proof, there is a subconscious thing that goes on when you see all those little pictures that identify an endorsement actually do trigger something in somebody's mind to say, hey, this person must know their stuff. They've got, you know, 90+ endorsements in all these different terms. They must know something more than this other person got. And recommendations. I mean, recommendations are a lot more weight. People have physically taken the time to write things down, to send that to you. It's personalized. It's, you know, they've had to take some time to think about that. So that's really, really important. Because when in doubt, when people are in doubt of who to do business with, they look at the decisions that others have made. Mm-hmm. So when they see somebody who's got, you know, 10, 15, 20 recommendations versus somebody that's got none, in their mind, they're like, this must be the better person. And here's the other thing that's really great about that. You know, sometimes I'll be speaking to people that I'll say, you know, Melonie, can you give me some, you know, references of some clients that you've worked with or whatever? I'm like, just go to my LinkedIn profile. I've got over 120 test, recommendations. All these people are available. You can click on their name if you want to learn more about who they are. I mean, it's all there, and it's legit. You can't fake it, right?
Yeah.
Websites, people have those testimonials with, you know, Mary B. I'm like, a testimonial isn't a testimonial unless you have every piece of information about that person, their first name, their last name, what city they live in, what, you know, company they're with. That's a real testimonial, not a Mary B.
Right. So why don't you kind of expand on that? How do you get powerful recommendations? How about some tips on getting people to use the terminology that's going to be helpful? Because I know people kind of struggle to craft a good recommendation, and maybe they don't use the right words to say, oh, Angelique was really great to work with, which is wonderful to hear, but it's not a really helpful recommendation to get more people to listen to. It's not a powerful testimonial. So how could you make it better? How can you help people?
Yeah, that's a great question. Well, the key is asking the right people, first of all, right? I get people that ask me on a daily basis for recommendations that I don't even know. I'm like, are you kidding me? Like, LinkedIn etiquette 101, don't ask
people. Oh, yeah. Wow, I can't believe people do that, right?
But something is really making sure that the people that you're asking are the right people. The people that, one, know you, like you, trust you, but two, can actually provide that level of a recommendation. So, for example, you know, if I had, you know, just experienced somebody very briefly, albeit I thought they were great and whatever, but I didn't have a real experience that I could identify with, then it's going to be kind of vague and fluffy, right? But if I've actually worked with somebody, they've actually helped me. Let's say there's a website person that designed a phenomenal website, and all of a sudden my website conversions went up dramatically, and I could speak to that, that's much more powerful. So there's a number of challenges with getting recommendations on LinkedIn. When you send out the request to somebody asking them for one, there's a whole bunch of variables that come into play. One, they get it on a day where they're just super swamped. They're busy. Everybody's busy. And they're like, oh, yeah, you know, I really like Angelique, and she's great, and I want to give her a recommendation, but I'm busy right now. So I'll get to this tomorrow. And then they never do. Then there's the person who you request that from, and they're like, gosh, I'd love to. I don't know what to write. What do I write? Let me think on that. Maybe I'll get to that in the next day or two. And then they never did.
Right.
And then there's the person that you send it to that would love to, but is like, not only do I not know what to write, but I'm a terrible writer. I have so many clients who are absolutely brilliant people, and they're terrible writers. We write all their content for them. We write all their stuff for them, right? And they're brilliant. And we'll interview them, and we'll get ideas from them, and we'll take their, we'll, you know, use their knowledge and their authentic voice through what we write and create for them, because we're interacting and that with them. But, you know, for other people, they just don't even know what to write. So one of the suggestions that I make is, first of all, if you're going to ask for a recommendation, tell people why. You know, they need to know why. Why do you want a recommendation? It could be as simple as, hey, you know, I've just started spending more time working on my LinkedIn profile, just redid it, and, you know, I sat in on this podcast or this video interview with a LinkedIn expert, and she mentioned the importance of recommendations, and I thought it really is time for me to go out and get some. It could be as simple as that, right? Or, you know, it's just time for me to up-level or I'm looking to start to use LinkedIn for business more or whatever that reason is, tell them the reason, because if you tell them a reason, they're more likely to do it. Okay. Then, and this is where you have to be willing to spend the time and spending more time at it than you might necessarily want to, and that's provide sample recommendations.
Right.
So for you, Angelique, you were saying, you know, you had situations where people would write, you know, Angelique was, you know, great to work with, whatever, but it was vague and it was fluffy. If you would have provided a sample of relevant to that person, that said, hey, you know what, a lot of people don't really know what to write, so I thought I'd go ahead, just help you out and provide a sample. Feel free to use any part of it. Don't use it at all. Whatever you want to do, that's fine with me. But I just want to make this as easy as possible because I am, you know, asking you.
Right.
The other thing that you can do, too, is offer to reciprocate, but only when appropriate. So, for example, I have a lot of people that will provide recommendations for me that have attended my seminars or speaking engagements or read my book or taken my online courses. I don't know them and I can't reciprocate. You know what I mean? So you have to make sure if you're going to reciprocate, it's making sure that you can truly vouch for that person. So to get recommendations, it takes a little bit more work to do it the way that I'm talking about. Personalize every single recommendation request, provide a sample, tell them why, offer to reciprocate if appropriate, and go those extra steps, and you'll get one 9 out of 10 times. Do it the generic way, send out the generic thing, 1 out of 10 times typically.
Right. Okay, that's awesome. That's really actionable. I'm glad you talked about how to do that. So what about some mistakes that people are making with LinkedIn? How can they, like, what are the biggest problems that you see besides not filling in their profile? What else do you see that people do wrong?
Well, the biggest thing is LinkedIn's tried to make everything nice and easy by providing all these default messages, right?
Yes.
I'd like to add you to my professional network. Will you recommend me, you know, all these different default messages? Save time. Well, it doesn't save time. It actually wastes time because you get no results from it.
Right.
You need to take the time to personalize the stuff that you're doing. Never send out those connection request messages that are generic. There's a number of reasons for that. One is, you know, some people are just really, really, really kind of crazy with their LinkedIn profile and that they kind of treat it like Facebook, like their personal profile where, you know, Facebook, most people don't want to accept people unless they're their immediate family and friends. And they start to treat LinkedIn like that. And they're like, well, who's this stranger wanting to connect with me? And there's nothing to establish anything with when you haven't told them why. So that connection request message needs to also establish why you want to connect with them. It might be as simple as saying, hey, you know what? I noticed that we're both in you know, the Vancouver area, and I love connecting with other like-minded, you know, professionals in Vancouver. You know, let's connect here on LinkedIn. You're giving them a reason why. I mean, it doesn't need to be super specific or, you know, really, I don't know what the word I'm looking for is, but just absolutely just personalizing it to speak to why you're wanting to connect with them. Now, that's just the mistakes that they make in the connection, and that can actually result in you actually getting restricted. Because if you start sending a connection request to people, and I think it's as little as 5,
right?
People hit report spam or I don't know this person, which is very likely for them to do when they're of that mindset, and you sent them a connection request and they don't know you, and they hit ignore, and then they follow that ignore button with the I don't know that person, now you're restricted. You go to basically LinkedIn jail. And it says that basically LinkedIn will not allow you to connect with another person unless you know their email address.
Right. Okay.
So as somebody who teaches and talks about, you know, using LinkedIn for lead generation, well, there goes your friggin' lead generation. You can't do it anymore. You can't be connecting with anybody that you don't know. So that's a big, big one, making sure that, you know, you're really personalizing things. Taking shortcuts result in wasting time, damaging your credibility, and potentially restricting your account.
Right. What about following up? Now, once you've made the connections, how do you suggest that people go about it? Because I know you're a really big advocate on, you know, customer service and building those relationships. So what can people do once they've made a connection, whether they've made the ask or whether someone's connected with them, obviously saying, hey, thanks for connecting. But what's another step that can make you more memorable when you connect with somebody or when someone connects with you?
Yeah, absolutely. This is exactly what I wrote about in my book, The LinkedIn Code, right? It's like, just writing how you write profile isn't enough. And a lot of times when I'll be speaking, people will be like, no, Melonie, I've been using LinkedIn for years and I've never gotten anything from it. And I'm like, well, what do you do? Well, I accept connection requests when somebody sends them and I send them to the people that I meet. And that's it. I'm like, so you're just basically magically waiting for business to come at your computer screen, you know? So the key is to build those relationships and move them forward. And one of the things that I talk about in my book is, you know, creating a message sequence, a lead generation message sequence that you follow up. So somebody accepts your connection request, you follow up with a message, and you don't do what those people out there do when they start pitching you the moment you've connected with them and they send you your sales emails, right? Hey, you want to, you know, do this, do that, buy this, see this, you know what I mean? It's just, so that turns people off immediately. That gets you reported as spam as well. So what you want to do is just reach out and provide some value. Start to establish some trust and some credibility with that person by providing some value. This is where content marketing and LinkedIn work so perfect together. Because if you're not a content creator, then you have to start leveraging other people's content and becoming a content curator. And there's nothing wrong with being a content curator, but you're never going to position yourself as an authority, as just simply a content curator. Your authority status is going to come from your knowledge of what it is that you do and the content that you create. Having said that, a perfect content marketing strategy involves content curation and content creation. So having some stuff that you provide as value to these people that are relevant to them. So remember I talked about the profile, getting really specific about who the people are that you're connecting with. I'll give you an example of this. When I first started out, when I first opened Top Dog Social Media, I basically had a very specific target audience I was going to go after. It was lawyers, doctors, accountants, professional service providers. And so instead of me creating a piece of content that was social media, you know, generic about social media, I created the guide to social media for accountants, the guide to social media for lawyers, the guide to social media for dentists, and I created specific things for them. So when you, if you were to send out a piece of content to, let's use an accountant as an example, that's specific to accountants, they're going to not only appreciate it, the likelihood of them reading it, much greater.
Right.
Hey, you know, don't know if you want some help with your social media, but, you know, I just wrote this really great article on social media. Who cares? It's not relevant to them. Right? So getting really relevant to them, providing some value. And then the goal is to do that a couple of times and then ultimately move the conversation offline. The biggest mistake that I see with everybody in online marketing, whether it's social media or, you know, just various forms of online marketing, is if you never move a relationship offline, nothing happens. Now, having said that, there's, of course, exceptions to that. I've got a book that's less than $20. I'm not going to have a conversation with every single person that buys my book. I don't have not enough hours in the day. I've got some low-priced online courses. I don't need to have conversations with people that buy them, but I do need to have a conversation with everybody that's going to invest in my services. So if you're going to hire me to create a LinkedIn lead generation campaign for you, or if you're going to hire me to do content marketing for you or do something, you know, train your sales team on social selling, it always revolves around a conversation. So, you know, in addition to not trying to sell and pitch online via social media, because selling via social media is very ineffective, the goal is to build up enough trust and credibility and get to that point where people want to actually have a conversation with you. Then you explore a little bit about who they are, what problems they're having, and make a recommendation for your solution if it's a fit.
Right.
And that's the key. That's the key to converting a prospect to a client. And it's one of the reasons why so many people don't actually end up getting results from LinkedIn or any other social media platform is because they haven't put a structure in place to actually get to that point and move those conversations offline.
Awesome. That those are some great tips, and it actually kind of addressed my next question for you was going to be why providing free things are really valuable in terms of, you know, education marketing. Did you want to talk a little bit more about it, or do you think you've answered the question already?
No, I think that's a really, really important topic and definitely worth elaborating a little bit further. Content marketing is basically a way to position yourself as an authority. It's also a way to get organic Google traffic to your website. LinkedIn and Google are my two number one referral sources for traffic to my website. Google above LinkedIn. So right. My content marketing gets me more traffic organically through Google than all the other stuff that we do, because we understand, one, how to create great content, how to optimize it for the search results, and how to get found. And so almost every conversation that I have with people that have inquired about services that we offer, like, how'd you hear about us, you know, how'd you find us, it was either LinkedIn or Google. So, you know, those two I just think are such a powerful combination. Education-based marketing is so important to keep you relevant, keep you top of mind, keep you providing value. And so many people are so worried about it because they're like, you know, how much is too much? Am I going to give away all my best stuff? Should I give away all my best stuff? And the answer is yes, because there's going to be a certain percentage of people that no matter how great you are, no matter how amazing you could actually be in terms of helping them with whatever their problem is, they're never going to invest in it. And then there's going to be people that are smart enough to know, Melonie just provided this amazing guide on exactly how to do this step by step. You know what? I could do that. Like, I've got a lot of content on how to create a great LinkedIn profile. They could do that because I provided the step-by-step stuff, but they're like, you know what, she's the expert. Why don't I just hire her to do it? So those are the people that you're after. You're after the people that you're educating, you're providing great value to. They know that they could probably do it themselves because you provided such great content, but they don't want to. They're like, I get paid to do what I do best. Why don't I pay that person that knows what they're doing to do that?
Right.
That's why content and education-based content is so important, and keeping the promotions in the education-based content to a minimum. You know, you can certainly talk about a little bit about what you do, but you don't use content as a way to sell. You use it as a way to educate, again, and stay relevant and stay top of mind.
And I remember you, in one of your webinars, you talked about not just addressing the 3% of the people who are, you know, really fighting and competing and who need your services now, but part of the education-based marketing is working with, you know, what was it, 30, 67% of the people who don't necessarily need you now but are looking to need your services in the future, or who don't even know that they need you, and that's what content marketing does.
And that's the best one of all, right? So there's so many people that don't know that they need certain things. So, for example, you know, when I explain to people how important your LinkedIn profile is, this is often your, you know, this is your personal brand. This is often the very first thing that people are going to find out about you if they're going to do any due diligence or research about you. It makes them realize the importance of having a great presence where they didn't even know that that was important before, because they're like, well, I'm not looking for a job. I don't need, you know, who cares, right? And then as soon as they learn and they understand, they're like, oh my gosh, I had no idea. This is important. Now I know I need this. And guess what? She's the one who just educated me on that. If I was going to use anybody's services, whether it was, you know, buying a book or a course or hiring somebody, it's going to be this person that just educated me about it.
Right. Okay, I think we've covered so much in 35 minutes. I can't believe we've just torn through all these questions, and we've given some really great tips for people to take action right away. So that is awesome. We do have a question. Why don't we just jump to the question right now? It's from Peter Comrie. Hi, Peter. How you doing? He says, Melonie, I'm able to use keyword search to identify my audience. Could you address which is better, send an initial in-mail to dialogue or request to connect?
The answer to every question that I'll ask is always, it depends. And hello, Peter. Sorry, Kelowna clan on. Yeah, wonderful. So the answer is, it depends. So if you are like wanting to connect with a very high-level executive, you know, C-suite, Fortune 500 company, you might want to go with the in-mail function, but I'm going to give you something even better, Peter, that I've never taught you before. And there's a way to actually send messages to people without sending that connection request for free, without paying for an expensive in-mail, if you're a member of the same group. So if you share even one group in common with them, all you have to do is go to that group, do a search of their name, and then their name, they'll appear in the search results, and you message, and you can actually message them for free. So in the case of you wanting to connect with a, you know, somebody that's pretty high level that you're like questionable, I'm not sure if they're going to accept it, this is where you can do something like that. You can send the email if you're not part of the same group. But if you are part of the group, you can send that message for free and save your emails and basically say, hey, you know, I really want to reach out to you and connect with you, and here's why. But I didn't want to go ahead and send you a connection request without just making sure that that was okay with you first. And that's a great way of kind of segueing into that.
Awesome. Yeah, that sounds like a great answer, and I think it's probably helped Peter. So if you have any follow-up, Peter, just give pop another question there, but I think she's answered what you're going to say. And that is a perfect segue into talking about how important groups are on LinkedIn and how you can really use them effectively to connect with people. I know that's something that you've talked a lot about, and people really underutilize and don't even realize they've got 50 different groups they can be take part in.
Right. And let me start by talking first about why groups are important, period. And that's in order for you, if you're going to use LinkedIn as a lead generation tool, you're going to start looking for your ideal prospects. You're going to start using advanced search and finding them, setting up these message sequence, connecting with them, moving that conversation offline. If you're going to do any of that stuff, you need to be able to have a network that's large enough to find them. And one of the fastest ways to expand your network, because here's how it works. You can only get found in the search results, and people can only find you if they're part of your first, second, third degree network or a member of the same group. And so because many groups have thousands upon thousands, some groups have tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of members in them, you exponentially increase your reach and the people that you can find and the people that can find you instantly. And you can do this 50 times with up to 50 groups. Now, there's a lot of other things. So some people might just want to join groups just for that purpose alone. They might not want to engage in them. They might not want to participate in them. That's all fine. You know, understanding what your motivation and objectives are for using them is key. Other times, you know, there will be groups where you can join that give you an opportunity to engage and really position yourself as, you know, an authority on your topic. And, you know, you can get to that top contributor ranking status where, you know, you're highlighted and a lot more people are seeing you. Whenever I add conversations into groups or share stuff within groups, I immediately start to get connection requests from people who've seen my posts and start connecting with me. And I recognize it because they commented, and then all of a sudden I see the same name from the comment in a connection request. So that really helps. And just understanding, you know, how you can benefit from groups. I mean, yes, you can. I post a lot of my content in groups too, and you have to be really careful about how you do this. There's kind of an art to doing it. Most people will just write a blog post and then they'll go share the link in a LinkedIn group and kind of look scammy. Like there's no, you know, it's just like, oh, okay, they're just trying to pitch their article. When I do it, I always create a conversation around it. So I pose it with a question, and then I use that piece of content as a reference to the conversation versus the conversation.
Right.
So, yeah, groups can be really, really effective in a number of different ways, but that's one of the immediate benefits of joining one is you can message people for free and exponentially increase your network size. And, you know, this is the other thing that's important while we're talking about network size, because a lot of people are like, you know, who should I connect with? Should I connect with competitors? Who should I connect with? My thing is, unless you can find a reason not to connect with somebody, and I find a lot of reasons not to connect with people at this point, you know, they look spammy, the, you know, profile, I don't even know if they're real, overseas, like possibility of, you know, getting spammed by them, just, you know, I have certain criteria that I look for, and I'm like, no. But however, having said that, I'll sometimes accept connection requests from people that I normally wouldn't when they personalize the message. Anytime they say, hey, you know, Melonie, I just bought your book, The LinkedIn Code, or I just read your book, love it, automatically I'm going to accept that, even if they were somebody that I wouldn't accept normally because they've taken the time to personalize that message, and I know that, you know, they totally know who I am. So it just makes sense. But a lot of times people are very, very apprehensive. So understanding that there's value in growing your network.
Right. Awesome. So Peter has come back and answered astoundingly addressed. Thanks a lot, Melonie. You rock.
Thank you, Peter. So do you.
Okay, so let's continue on groups. What type of groups should people join? Because I think people make the mistake of joining groups of their peers when that's not who their target audience is. So how about you talk a little more about that?
Yeah, and exactly. That's exactly what most people do. So the financial advisors, all the financial advisor groups. The realtors, join all the real estate groups. You need to join the groups where you can find your ideal clients. You don't need to be networking and whatnot with your peers. And having said that, you might want to join a couple of industry-specific groups to stay up to date on what's going on in your industry, what's going on with your peers and your competitors. But the vast majority of the groups that you join should be groups that are relevant to where you can find your ideal clients. So if you're a financial advisor and you know your ideal clients are business owners in you know your specific city, then do searches for you know your city name. If you're local, this is really easy. You just kind of start to add your city name, see all the groups that are relevant, join those groups. If you're not local in terms of you know who you serve as your clientele, then you can start to narrow it down to the specific types of people, business owners, entrepreneurs, doctors, dentists, whatever it is, right? So that's the key, is figuring out where are your ideal clients spending time. And the other thing is review your groups, you know, once a quarter. What groups are working for me and what aren't? You know, what groups are filled with spam or you know, the wrong types of people, they're not being moderated or there's no activity in them. What groups should I be unjoining and finding some new groups? You don't have to stick with the same groups all the time. One other thing, too, is there's ways in your settings. This is really important. I cover this all the time when I'm doing trainings, is to shut off all the notifications. Because if you join 50 groups, join a group, the default settings will be that you get a daily digest for the group.
That's, yes.
That's 50 friggin' emails a day.
Yeah.
You don't want any of those. So you want to change that to either no emails or to weekly digest. So once a week, you can scan and scroll through and see if there's anything. And there might be some groups where you've just joined not necessarily to engage in those groups, but more to you know, expand your network with a specific target audience. You might not want an email at all for those. So just understanding you know, where do you want emails and who do you want emails from? Because that is a pain in the butt, getting 50 of those a day.
Yeah, I've had the same thing happen myself, and it took me realizing, oh my God, my email box is full of all these people's notifications. I'm like, oh yeah, I forgot to turn those off.
Yeah.
Okay, so what about LinkedIn Pulse and creating basically blog posts on LinkedIn? I've seen you doing that a lot, and it seems like it's pretty valuable. So how do you do that? I mean, I've started to repurpose some of my content and post it out there on LinkedIn Pulse. So yeah, how do you use it?
Yeah, it's LinkedIn Publisher. So LinkedIn Publisher, LinkedIn Publisher used to be just for in the influencer network. So it was you know the top CEOs and celebrities and people like that were posting content to LinkedIn in the form of blog posts. And now LinkedIn's opened it up to everybody. So I say everybody, except for there are some people that haven't activated it yet, haven't got it yet. It will be available to everybody shortly. And so what we have found is we've been posting content, you know, for ourselves and also for a lot of our clients. And so some of our clients who, you know, maybe have websites that don't get nearly as much traffic as we get on our website are seeing phenomenal results in posting on LinkedIn Publisher. Because they're seeing, you know, 10, 20 times more traffic than they'd see to their blog. Now, having said that, my overall views and opinions of anything to do with social media is I use it strictly as a tool to drive traffic to my online real estate. Mm. The things that I truly care about are the things that I own and control, and that's my website and my email list. And I use social media as a tool to drive traffic to those two things. So drive traffic to my website, getting people opted into my email list, because those are the things at the end of the day that I own and control. And if LinkedIn or Facebook or Twitter or any of these things go out of business and they're gone, I've still benefited from them massively. And so one of the things that I'll suggest is, you know, post blog posts on your website a week or so later, maybe 2 weeks later, whatever, or go back and repurpose the content that you have that's older that is still highly relevant, and start sharing it on LinkedIn. You don't have to, you know, start creating content for this and for this. you know, otherwise it becomes very, very time consuming, right? Think that you got to create content for all these. I mean, I write for a number of different online magazines and Social Media Examiner and the Canadian Business Journal and all these different places, and I have to come up with original content every freaking time I do that. It's a pain in the butt, you know? Whereas with LinkedIn Publisher, you can just literally repurpose some of your blog content and get a potentially more of an audience that you're getting existing with your blog, especially if you've got a larger network. One of the great things about posting to LinkedIn Publisher is there's that notification. Every single time somebody in your network posts to Publisher, you're getting a notification. So that's a good thing and it's a bad thing. When you have a network like mine that's over 20,000 people, it's a pain in the butt. That's all I'm seeing. But for, you know, the average person, you know, not every single person's posting on Publisher, so they're actually seeing it. A lot of people are seeing it. We have one of our clients who, you know, just posted an article the other day. Within an hour of his article being posted on LinkedIn Publisher, he already had 800 views, more comments than he's had on any of his blog posts, likes, and this was only within an hour. We're like, wow, this is great, you know? So, and it was interesting because he had a network of about 2,000 people. That was like a very large percentage of the people in his network that actually viewed his article because of that notification.
Right. Okay. So what about commenting on people's on other people's status updates or in groups or on things that people have published? How valuable is that to get in front of other people?
Well, one of the ways that that's very valuable is to stay top of mind with your target audience, right? So if somebody's, you know, I have a ton of people that share my content on a regular basis. I know and I watch those people all the time. They're always sharing my content. I'm always, you know, thanking them for it. But one of the things that we do is we create, like on Twitter, for example, this is more relevant to Twitter, but I also pay attention to it on LinkedIn. We create lists of people who share our content on a regular basis, and we just call them, you know, people who retweet. We just have our
for it. Yeah, I've got a list like that too. Yeah.
And we go in and we see, hey, are any of our, you know, basically our evangelists, the people that are promoting us, our advocates, are they sharing that are sharing our stuff? What are they writing that's relevant and good to our audience? And we start sharing their stuff. So they've built relationships with us by doing stuff like that. So it's very relevant. And let's talk from a more business perspective in terms of leads and clients, potential clients. By staying top of mind with potential prospects, you know, they might not be in the position to make a decision on what you offer right now, today. It might be 3 months, 6 months from now. And if you stay relevant, you stay top of mind over the next 3 to 6 months, you will be the first person that they think of. I've had a number of people reach out to me and, you know, want something, some kind of a service that we offer, and literally come back a year later. So, you know, the timing just wasn't right.
Okay. I think that pretty much covers everything. My goodness, we've talked about so much today. I can't believe how much material we've gone through in 45 minutes.
Yeah, we have gone through a lot.
I'm just going through any of the other questions I had to ask you. And I don't see any more questions that have been posted from viewers. I'm just looking right now.
So, Angelique, one of the biggest questions that I always get asked every single time I speak an event is, what's the difference between a company page and a personal profile?
Oh, right, good.
I actually get some leverage from my company page, and that's one of the things that people always ask. And,
okay.
And one of the things that I say is, that, I mean, you know, if you have a business, obviously you should have a company page that represents, you know, that looks professional and whatnot, because people are doing searches and, you know, you need to be found. But no results really come from a LinkedIn company page unless you're going to pay for ads or sponsored posts, which isn't a bad idea to do if you've got some great content from time to time. But the reality of it is the results come on LinkedIn from your personal profile, because people want to deal with people, not logos.
Right.
All these people are fixated on, how do I get more results from my company page? You don't. You don't worry about it. Mm. I don't worry about it. You get your results from the real relationships you develop with real people that get to see your face. That's why your picture is so important, because people can't relate to a logo on a company page, but they relate to a person when they see their eyes, and obviously video takes it to the next level. So really understanding that that's where the results are going to come, using it personally and building those relationships. So creating the right content to be sharing on a regular basis, staying in touch with people, not just accepting connection requests and never doing anything with it, moving those relationships forward and offline, not trying to sell or pitch through the process, saving that for, and I don't mean save it for, but save it for a conversation where you actually have the opportunity to learn. Because how can you sell or pitch something you don't even know what that person needs?
Mm-hmm.
You need to ask some questions first. You need to understand where they're at, what they need, and then that's when you have that conversation about how you can potentially help them.
Great, and that's a really good summary for what we've talked about already. But if you could give one piece of advice to someone who's just starting their LinkedIn profile, I know a lot of people just kind of accept connection requests and then finally one day say, you know, I've got all these requests and I don't know what to do with LinkedIn. What should people do to just get started with LinkedIn? What are one or two things that they should do right away?
The one thing I think they need to do is definitely spend the time. You know, one of the great things about your LinkedIn profile is you do it once. Unless something's changed in your business, you might go in and do a little tweak here and there, but there's not much that you're going to do. So spend the time, energy, or investment, whatever it is that you choose based on what's right for you, and put that time into making sure that you do it. It is your personal brand. Make sure that your personal brand is reflecting what you want it to be reflecting. And then take some time to build a network. You know, your network today is essentially your net worth.
Right. Your network is your net worth. Awesome. Tweetable.
Yeah. So what you're building, you keep with you forever. And so a lot of times I get hired by companies, I train sales teams, and I'm like, you guys have no idea how lucky you are that your company is paying for you to learn all this stuff, because your profile is going to look great. You're going to know what to do. You're going to understand LinkedIn etiquette and the do's and don'ts and all that kind of stuff and how to, you know, use it for lead generation. And you're going to build a network that you take with you no matter where you go. So when you change jobs, for example, for professionals that are doing it, it's all yours. You take it with you. So, you know, building it, you know, over time is essential to continuing to keep the momentum going in whatever it is you're doing, this business or your next one.
Great tip. Okay, I've just taken a look and I don't see any other questions. It looks like you've been pretty thorough in covering everything that people would want to know so far about LinkedIn. Why don't you just finish it off with how people can get in touch with you, and if there's anything that you can offer them, or some links, or and actually tell a little bit about LinkedIn Code.
Yeah, absolutely. So, well, one of the things that we do is we create LinkedIn campaigns for people where we write their profile, create these message scripts, and show them basically how to create a lead generation campaign. And my book came from that, where I was like, there's so many people that need that, that might be in a place where they're just starting out or they can't afford to hire somebody to do that stuff for them. So I documented the entire process of what we do step by step in the book, including covering LinkedIn etiquette and best practices and things they need to, you know, do, not do, what to look for, and how to create those messages, how to, you know, manage them and move that forward. So that's my book, The LinkedIn Code. You can find it more. It's on Amazon, but there's a web page that you can go and learn a little bit more about it. It's thelinkedincode.com. If you're interested in connecting with me on social media, my primary website is topdogsocialmedia.com with links to all my social media sites. If you do want to connect with me on LinkedIn, I just ask that you personalize that note, that connect request. Oh, and here's a super tip for everybody. When I speak at events, a lot of times I'll tell people, feel free to connect with me, just make sure you personalize the note. Then I'll get these panicked messages from people that will have sent me the generic one, and then they'll follow it up and saying, oh my God, Melonie, I'm so sorry. I meant to personalize it, but when I clicked connect, it just sent it. It didn't allow me to personalize it. That's what happens on apps. So on the iPhone, on the iPad, it doesn't allow you to personalize. So if you're going to do any kind of lead generation activities, any kind of prospecting, any kind of connecting with prospects, anybody that's not your immediate friends or family, don't do it from an iPad or an iPhone or whatever phone. You do it from your desktop computer so that you do have that ability to actually personalize those messages.
Fantastic. We just talked about that in one of my social media groups today, and I think there's a new app that's come out that you might be able to actually personalize the message. Have you heard about it? If not, if I see anything about it, I can always pass it on to you.
Yeah, I just don't really use the apps because I like the functionality of doing things on, you know, having all the access. But yeah, they should be definitely changing that, and hopefully soon.
Yeah. Awesome. So we will wrap it up. Thank you so much today for all of your information on LinkedIn, Melonie. It was fabulous. Lots of actionable tips. So if you're watching today or if you're watching the replay, definitely some good tips here to get you started right away. So these are things that you can take action on. You don't need to wait and build up over time. You can do a few little steps every week and build a fantastic lead generating LinkedIn profile. And definitely connect with Melonie. She is on all the social networks. And yeah, thank you so much for being here, Melonie. It was a pleasure to have you on the show.
Thank you, Angelique. My pleasure.
And thank you, everybody, too, for joining us and taking time out of your day. So my name is Angelique Duffield from Bright Spark Media, and thank you for watching The Power of Free Show, where we help entrepreneurs and business owners with guest experts coming on to talk about the free tools and resources they use to build a thriving online business. It takes place on the first and third Thursday of the month, and we've got lots of good stuff coming up. In 2 weeks, we're going to have our topic is visual marketing, so be sure to join us for that one. And all the show notes and the links that we've talked about will be under the YouTube video and on my blog later. So pop on over. My website is on my banner, so brightsparkmedia.ca. Looking forward to seeing you next time, and thank you for joining us. Bye-bye.